just don't play with me, my paper heart will bleed. This wait for destiny won't do. Be with us, please, we beseech you, for another episode of Columbia House Party. Jake, what's up, man?
Oh, not much. Just another day inside.
All right. Today, in keeping with the general theme we've had of guests much cooler than us, who after the podcast, the Discord chat will be like, oh, you should bring them on more often instead of you and Jake. We also have a guest today who is a bigger expert than us. She quite literally wrote the book on a lot of the music that we talk about here on this podcast. We're going to keep it more on the pop punk side today, depending on how you draw those definitional lines. As usual, we don't want to upset our emo by calling the wrong thing emo. So we'll say pop punk, but our guest today wrote the book on emo, broader spectrum. Today's album, and really the first two albums from this band, are so of the moment in the mid-2000s pop-punk boom that I can't help but picture the LimeWire downloading progress bar when the lead singles hit. Despite that representative sound and a signature vocalist with several signature performances, this band almost seems under-discussed as a pop-punk boom success story. Today, we get into a little bit of why that is as we discuss the self-titled 2003 debut album from the All-American Rejects.
Their world, time goes by, secrets rise. One more sad song, tears shed. She's gone, she'd take it back if she only could. And all the perfect words, they seem so wrong. She's gone. You wish that you could learn to see the doors closed and you.
Better to help us navigate an important early 2000s emo or pop punk act than the author of From the Basement, A History of Emo Music and How It Changed Society. Today, we're joined by Taylor Markarian. Taylor, welcome and thank you for coming on.
Thank you. Thanks so much for that very special introduction. I was very impressed.
Thank you. I'm glad. Guys, if you're listening and you don't know Taylor, you can follow her at TK Markarian on socials. And please check out her book, From the Basement. It's available on Indigo, Barnes & Noble, wherever you get your books. And then also, you know, if you follow her on Twitter, keep an eye out for her freelance work and things like that. So we're going to talk about the All-American Rejects today. Taylor, before we get into the album and why you chose it, I wanted to talk a little bit about your book, From the Basement. It's really good. I enjoyed it. I think I told you when I emailed you asking you to come on that I've read quotes from it on this podcast in the past. So you are already a part of the podcast as source material. And it's great. So I'm curious, you know, how the idea came about for you and what the process was like putting that together, because not only is it a really great book for someone who was into that scene and remains into that music, but the way you structured it as kind of like this oral history was unique, and it was awesome. It made it for a really fun read and a really quick read too, if anyone's looking for something to relive some of your early to mid 2000s favorites. So Taylor, what was that process like?
Well, first of all, I am really curious to know which quotes of mine you used. I'm probably going to go back and look those up. but It was very strange because I had this idea about writing a book about emo music because I kind of thought it hadn't really been done in a comprehensive way before as an oral history. And I kind of shelved it for a little while, but then randomly this indie publisher, Mango Publishing in Florida, reached out to me and they had seen a lot of my freelance work and liked it and asked me, would I want to write a book about emo music? So it was this very strange thing where all the stars kind of aligned and it gave me the push I needed to write this book.
That's great. And then, so the process, I'd imagine you had a lot of contacts already, but was it like, I guess what I'm curious about, because I write about basketball and like I've pitched books in the past before too. I've written one as well, but it was only like it was writing someone's biography for them. So not the same thing. I'm curious, like process wise, did you kind of have an idea of what the book would look like? Or did you kind of just like, I'm going to do all of these interviews with bands I think are important to the scene and we'll see what the book looks like from there?
So what really laid the foundation for me was the oral history of punk music by Legs McNeil, Please Kill Me. It was just an oral history. So there were no personal narratives in it. It was strictly interviews and quotes from people who were important to the proto-punk and punk scene, you know, growing out of New York especially. So that was kind of my model for what I wanted to do. But I also, you know, I'm also a creative writer, and I did want to share my personal connection to the music because it's such a personal genre of music. Certain genres of music you can kind of look at more objectively, but emo, by definition of being emo, is you're really personally invested in it. So I didn't think it would be complete without interrupting some of those interviews with my own personal narration and experiences.
Yeah, which makes the book more, to me, more enjoyable to know how that kind of, how these quotes and how these moments and topics weaved through your own life as well. I also really appreciate, we've joked on this podcast a lot over the past however many episodes about how like there are certain subsets of music fans who are cool with like using broad definitions of genres. And then there are like every third post on the emo subreddit is arguing whether or not something belongs on the subreddit. So I was very thankful that not only did you address that a lot of bands don't like the emo label, but you were, you know, open to just like, you could just call it emo. It's fine. It's yeah. So that was appreciated. And that was something that I have taken direction from on this podcast where it's like, you know what, I'm, whether it's pop punk or post hardcore, whatever, if I want to call it emo and I have an emotional attachment to it, I'm going to be fine with that. So thank you for that.
Good. I'm glad to help somebody figure it out. As I said in the book, I really don't care what it's called. Everybody knows the word emo. Everybody assigns it to a certain set of bands and a certain kind of sound. So why not use it? It's more historical by this point anyway. So I don't think people should be so insulted anymore.
The news stories is your child an emo, I guess, have sort of gone by the wayside a little bit.
Yeah. I mean, my mom still has it bookmarked, I think, but you know, is your adult son an emo?
I think by here now are the telltale signs.
Yeah. So Taylor, you were definitely one of the most ready with options guests that we've had when we reached out. You sent us 5 albums that you said you hadn't already talked about to death and aren't too obvious. We picked 2 of them and we put it to a Patreon vote. Much to my chagrin, the starting line lost to the All-American Rejects. It's not that I don't like the All-American Rejects. I do, but I don't know many other guest options who would be excited and eager to talk about the starting line, and I don't know that I could drag Jake into doing one where just like I talk for the whole episode.
I can do the starting line. I had my moment with them.
Well, if it makes you feel any better, I the first show I ever went to was a starting line All American Rejects show. So there's a connection. Wow.
Perfect. Yeah. Perfect. We put it to a vote with our listeners, and All American Rejects got 70% of the vote. So sorry to the starting really? Line. Sorry to all of Ohio. We apologize. We don't have the listenership in Ohio for, I guess, you know, Oklahoma pop punk is bigger on for this podcast listenership. Taylor, you'd also given us Silverstein, Census Fail, and Armor for Sleep as options. But again, the All-American Rejects self-titled album won the vote. So I'm curious, why this album for you before we get into some of the details of the album itself?
So it was one of the first quote unquote emo or pop punk, whatever you want to call it, records that I listened to. This record, Taking Back Sundays, Tell All Your Friends,
oh, yeah,
and Senses Fail's debut record, those were the three records that really were my introduction to this alternative, slightly edgier type of music. And the All-American Rejects are actually the least edgy out of them all. They're really poppy, and you could almost get away with laughing at the songs if they didn't already mean so much to you.
Yeah, I definitely understood that going back and re-listening. You mentioned Taking Back Sunday, who are, of course, from Long Island, and Armor for Sleep, who are from New Jersey, are one of the options here. Sorry, I'm not sure. Did you grow up in New Jersey or New York? And then my follow-up to that would be, how much do you think that influenced kind of your music taste? Because New Jersey and Pennsylvania were kind of like it for this scene for a little bit there.
Yeah, so I was born in New York City, and I grew up about 20-30 minutes away from the city. So I have spent my life pretty much split between New Jersey and New York. It definitely did affect the music that I listened to, because I only started listening to this type of rock music when my best friend growing up, when her big brother's band was, you know, doing the Battle of the Bands at high school. And, you know, they were listening to the Get Up Kids and Glassjaw and all these other bands. And so that was really my gateway. And it was also really interesting because that same family, their cousin was Matt Rubano, who was the bassist for a while in Taking Back Sunday. And I think he may have also done a stint with the All-American Rejects too at some point.
Good. Those are two good bands to have on your resume. Jake, what about you, man? Did you have, we didn't really do much like pre-recording talk about this one. Did you have much association with All-American Rejects, or was this a lot of revisiting for you?
This one's kind of a weird one for me because it's kind of both. I don't think I ever actually owned this album, but for some reason, All-American Rejects are a very, like, trigger very, very nostalgic feelings for me. Like, obviously I was aware of Swing Swing when that came out. And I don't know if it's just because of like seeing that video so much when I was kind of getting into this type of music, but like they were always a band that were always kind of at arm's length for me, but I was always very intrigued by, and I don't really know why I never dug into them comparatively to other bands around this time that I did get very into. They very much sort of, what we were talking before, they do very much occupy sort of the same space in my brain that something like The Starting Line does. But I am much more, like, I just have very clear memories of thinking this band was interesting, but then just never getting into them. And it's not for dislike. I just don't know why, but Swing Swing was definitely one of those like early songs of this sound that piqued my interest, and also was like, oh, okay. I think they were a weirdly important band almost unconsciously for me, in the sense that they were like, it's okay to sound poppier, and like not everything needs to have like an edge to it when you're 14. But I didn't really go back to or listen to like the full album more than once until prepping for this. And it's an interesting one to me because it's sort of exactly what I thought it would be in a good way, and also in what makes think that like my instincts when I was younger was kind of right.
You know, I don't want to speak for you, but I wonder if they were just kind of, you know, and the music wasn't consumed the same way in, and so this wouldn't hold up, you know, this certainly doesn't hold up in like the record sales from that era and stuff. But to me, they were more of a, what now would be like a singles band versus an album band, where I listened to a lot of All-American Rejects, but like, I don't know that I had their CD in my car, but they were probably, there was probably an All-American Reject song on every mixtape in my car.
Yeah, I think that's a great way to look at it.
We're going to talk more about the All-American Rejects self-titled debut after this. The All-American Rejects have a fairly standard origin story. Tyson Ritter, the bassist and vocalist, and Nick Wheeler, now the guitarist but originally the drummer, met at a party in high school in Stillwater, Oklahoma. They did the Same Girl, New Songs demo EP, which is an amazing title for an EP. It also included One More Sad Song, which we played off the top, and an early version of a couple of songs that would eventually make the self-titled LP, including this early version of Why Worry, where Tyson Ritter is like kind of going away from his own vocals and doing like a Billy Joe Armstrong kind of thing. I dug this one up on YouTube because you can't find the Same Girl, New Songs demo EP very easily. This is the original cut of Why Worry.
Time, why worry? It's killing me. Forget about it. I whisper, remember what she did, don't miss her.
I feel like you probably have some thoughts on his vocals there versus his vocals on the actual album.
Look, are there recordings somewhere of me that sound very similar to this somewhere? Who's to say? But I don't know. I think it's like the best instrument in this band is his vocals. And I'm glad that he sort of embraced that, I guess.
Yeah, I mean, it's good. It polished up. But I think, you know, you go back and you hear some of the demos and they basically had the formula down. They just had to kind of polish it up. So the origin story here is that an intern at Doghouse Records allegedly saved this demo from the trash and gave it to Dirk Hemsath, who was the head of Doghouse Records. And he liked them and kind of they went to bat from there and they landed with Doghouse. They originally had Jesse Tabish on guitar and Wheeler on drums, but Tabish left. So their self-titled is the very rare two-person pop punk album. So for a while, it was just the two of them. So Ritter and Wheeler shared all the songwriting duties, and then Ritter sang lead vocals and played bass and did some of his own backing vocals, while Wheeler did lead and rhythm guitar, keyboard, drums, and basically whatever else was needed. So a lot going on for just two guys. Before we get into some song by song from the album, Taylor, were they on your radar at all before the album came out, or was this kind of were you like a hardcore, like finding the demos or these like unheard of EPs at that time? Or was it once they started becoming popular, then they got on your radar?
So it was kind of in between. I was kind of too young at the time to be obsessively sifting through demos. And this was introduced to me by the same friend and family that I was telling you about. I definitely listened to the whole record. Like, while you said, and I totally agree, that most people saw them for their singles, I definitely spent a lot of time with the whole record.
So we're going to get into the whole record here now. The album opens with this very punchy emo track called My Paper Heart, which it kind of feels like two songs in one. Like, I feel like you could put a split in the middle of that song and it would be fine as two songs, and they'd both be around like 2 minutes or shorter, so they'd sound like kind of pre-Joyce Manor emo songs. But instead, you have this four-minute opener that's like really quirky. It's called My Paper Heart, and it sounds like this.
Please just don't play with me. My paper heart will bleed. This wait for destiny.
So Taylor, that was one of the songs specifically you had mentioned wanting to talk about off of this album. What did that song mean to you, or why does that song stand out for you?
Well, first of all, it was my screen name for AIM. So that should tell you how important it is to me. But it's also, it's just so classically emo, not even just necessarily by sound, but the title, the lyrics, it's so upfront and just very plain spoken about having these emotions that other people can probably make fun of you for, but it's very self-confident, and I really liked that, especially because it's not entirely sad like a lot of other emo records or songs can be. It's got a lot of bounciness to it.
Yeah, that little kind of synthy open to it, and the, you know, it's something that they do well on a lot of their songs. Is like you said, it's not quite as sad and morose as some of the other ones, and it's certainly, you know, they are generally not as angry as some of the other sad bands from this time. So it makes it like a little more playful to be, you know, to like sit in those emotions when you listen to it, or at least when I listened to it in high school, it was like, you know, didn't seem quite as you know, some really sad music. You can feel a little like you're almost fetishizing or encouraging the sadness. You don't get that with that song. It's a little nice and upbeat. It's a good start. I also think it's a good intro to the All American Rejects. Like if someone was like, I'd never heard this band, like what is all early All American Rejects about? Because it is so like just like literal and like here are my feelings and we're gonna have some fun playing around with them. It's a really good intro to their very first album, so it makes sense as an album starter. Jake, I'd imagine that's one of the All American Rejects songs you'd heard. It wasn't a single itself, but it was pretty, at least in the LimeWire circles, it was no trouble to find a download.
Yeah, it was definitely around, and I also think it's kind of an interesting song lyrically, in the sense of, you know, you and I have talked a lot on this show about the quote-unquote like classic emo bands. And like, I don't think these guys really get mentioned in that, but lyrically, if not musically, it's so in line with that kind of stuff. Like just that opening line, like my paper heart will bleed, is so quintessential to that sound. And like, there are so many bands that have songs that like either personify or cast violence on their hearts. And I think like, it's just like, okay, I know what year this is, I know what genre I'm listening to, but it is more, like, I was surprised going back to this, how, I'm not sure if it's just the synth, but it reminds me of some of, like, almost later, like, Motion City Soundtrack kind of stuff, and it's a lot more music.
Get the mood.
Yeah, it was, like, a lot more musically dynamic than I think I was really expecting it to be.
Especially for just two people.
Right, yeah, I didn't know that. That's quite impressive.
Taylor, this is bad hosting on my part. I have a follow-up from something you said earlier. Do you remember specifically what your AIM screen name was? Was it just like My Paper Heart? Or was it like one of those ones where you use like the brackets and the dashes to like draw it out? Or what are we talking specifically? Because I have some terribly embarrassing MSN messenger statuses in my closet too.
Well, the username, I guess I can say it. I don't think you can really look up much about me by my AIM username at this point. It was My Paper Heart XO11.
Yeah,
pretty appropriate for the time. But yeah, definitely for my AIM, like away statuses and things, it was always quotes from, you know, AAR songs or Taking Back Sunday songs, Starting Line, all that. And I thought I was really clever, but you know, now we know better.
No, I mean, hey, part of being clever is knowing which clever people to borrow from so that people think you're clever. The Starting Line were great for that, because like the Starting Line, at least in like my music circles, were a little more obscure. And I always found their songwriting to be very clever and witty. They were a deep well of MSN status resource. I don't know if this is like, I think this is a Canada-US thing, but like AIM wasn't quite as big here. We were more of an MSN messenger.
An MSN messenger, we were able to like write song lyrics after our usernames, so we could get like full stanzas in there from bands for our stuff.
You get a whole verse in there if you try hard enough. Okay, so the album from My Paper Heart gets into its single heavy middle of the order. Album's structured pretty well with, you know, I think My Paper Heart, other than the fact that it's longer and almost feels like a wrap up, like it could be a closer as well. But I think tone setting wise, it's a good starter. It also being 4 minutes kind of gets you ready for this almost counter genre. It's 11 songs in 42 minutes, which is, you know, kind of antithetical to pop punk, or at least like what gets produced now. Anyway, structurally, it then gets into a pretty single heavy middle, which is led, of course, by what I would imagine is the song that got a lot of people into the All-American Rejects at first, Swing Swing. Again, I like My Paper Heart as an album opener, especially on a debut album, because it tells you about the band so well. But I feel like the Swing Swing, like in terms of how it sounds, would be a really good album opener. Jake, you have more stronger takes on album sequencing. How do you feel about that?
I think I agree. Like, just how, I don't know, it's personal taste, but like, I'm a big fan of those kind of like, it sounds like the opening of like a musical when you have like the one instrument leads you in and then the whole band kicks in. And like Paper Heart's a really good song, but it just kind of like kicks in immediately. I'm the person who thinks that Welcome to the Black Parade should be the first song on the Black Parade for similar reasons. So I'm with you on that one, I think.
Taylor, Swing Swing was enormous, and I think I'm a little older than you, but I'd imagine it was probably, was it your introduction to them? Like, was that the first All-American Reject song you remember hearing from your friend?
Yeah, it was.
So that was another one that, like, I mean, obviously we're not going to talk about the All-American Rejects album and not talk about Swing Swing. But did that song have the same kind of like emotional attachment for you as My Paper Heart? Like, did this song mean much to you, or was it mostly just like kind of, you know, your gateway into the band and it's meaningful in that sense?
I mean, every song on this record means so much to me, to be honest. There's not one song I like less than another. But Swing Swing is, you know, obviously it's kind of like the All-American Rejects anthem. It was the first song I heard by them. And it does give me, you know, those warm and fuzzy feelings inside when I hear those first few bars. So it's kind of by word association. It's one of those things where it's like you say All-American Rejects, you say Swing Swing. So I think it's very indicative of their kind of musical identity.
For sure. I think that's well said. It was also a relatively big success for a debuting pop punk act. It hit number 60 on the US charts and number 8 on the US alternative. Peaked at number 13 in the UK. For a single, kind of for an out of nowhere band on a small label, that's really great. I think what it probably did for the success of this album, and more importantly, which we'll talk about, it is the momentum going in to Move Along, is this song Swing Swing is such a great showcase of Ritter as a frontman. And like Jake, like you said, like his vocal talent is such a big strength of this band, and such a big strength too, like relative to some of the bands that got popular around the same time, didn't have like the same, obviously there were charismatic or engaging frontmen, otherwise the bands don't get popular, but in terms of just like raw singing talent, he's, you know, a step ahead of the average at least. And, you know, maybe not quite in the Patrick Stump category, but he's like, he's pretty good. Do you have any feelings on this song or like Ritter as a front man?
Yeah, I think that I noticed it a bunch, like listening to the album as a whole, but his ability to sort of, to like hit that high register well, but like control it and make it very quick and then go back to his sort of normal range, I think is, I mean, A, it's really hard to do, and B, it's not something you heard a lot in this genre, I think. Like, there's kind of three, maybe, quote-unquote emo singing voices. Like, you know, you have your Gerard Way's, who is also an amazing singer, but in a very different way. You have your sort of Dallas Greens or Stumps, and you have your, like, rough vocal guys. But there's not a lot of, like, pretty singers vocally, both, I mean physically and vocally, but speaking
those cheekbones, man.
Oh, don't even
speaking
get me
specifically
started.
Vocally.
Oh, we're gonna talk a little about after we get through the album, it's I'm gonna try not to just outright objectify him, but we're gonna talk some more Tyson Ritter.
But I think like there's not a lot of like pretty vocals for such a pop heavy genre. I think because it was sort of a genre made by like not your typical sounds, which is a good thing. There were a few, like Patrick Stump is one, but I think that like he's just got such a nice voice, and it's such a like talented, controlled voice that I think both makes them sound poppier, but also makes them kind of like stand on their own a little bit.
One question that comes to mind with this band, and like this is a stupid question, so just ignore me, Taylor, if it's that stupid. But like, I feel like the name The All American Rejects suits the music really well and the lyrics really well and the genre really well. But I feel like it doesn't suit Tyson Ritter well. Like, I feel like he's too like polished a singer, and like he looked like a leading man actor from like 19. I feel like he was probably not a reject.
Maybe not with the ladies.
He was probably very popular. Yeah.
But I mean, I don't know him personally. I can't attest to that. But you know, I think there's something about just not only just experiencing those kinds of emotions, but putting them on your sleeve for the world to see, that falls very well in line with the phrase All American Reject, because it's not something, those emotions weren't typically accepted.
Mm-hmm.
And this is something that your book talks about a lot, about how the kind of emo boom and the way that people approach music and the way that I think for people like us, it made it a little easier to deal with those feelings. And I feel like, and I don't know if they intended this, but when you say All American Rejects, what I think of with All American is like someone in like some fratty guy in high school wearing a Letterman jacket. And the All American Rejects, to me, it gives me this picture of like someone almost literally wearing their heart on their sleeve in the same way. It's like, okay, sports is your identity and like feelings are my identity. So I really like the name through that perspective. And like you said, I feel like it suits the music so well, and like the moment and why people like us attach to it. From Swing Swing, they released The Last Song and Time Stands Still as singles. Neither charted nearly as well. The Last Song is a pretty good album closer, which then makes sense why My Paper Heart goes at the top. But I don't know about the strategy of releasing a 5-minute single in this genre. It's just a little tough. Time Stands Still is more of a single-oriented one, has a bit more funk to it with Since the Start Again, and then the acoustic comes in, and then the rolling drum comes in to a very like late 90s alt-rock melody. Time Stands Still, the third single, sounds like this. Jake, is that one that was on your radar? I know that like it was a single, but I don't remember Time Stand Still being as big a All-American Reject song. So for a more casual fan, I'm wondering if that one was on your radar at all.
No, I didn't know that one. It was mostly Swing Swing. And then like later, I guess the next record with Move Along, that was definitely around there. But this one wasn't really sort of, this one wasn't like it's not a song that I associate as much with the time or the genre as the other two.
Taylor, I know this was a song that you really like. And like you said, I know you said that all the songs on the album kind of hold a place for you, but what are your thoughts on Time Stand Still? And was that one, I mean, I guess at that point you were listening to the whole album, but why does it stand out for you in retrospect?
So if I did have to pick a favorite song, it would be Time Stand Still. And that's not just for the All-American Rejects record. That's definitely up there amongst my top 10 favorite songs. I don't know why. There's something so simple about their songwriting, but the melody and the way that Tyson delivers it is just so graspable. I feel like it's so easy to connect with, and it's one of those feel good songs for me, even if all of the emotions in there aren't necessarily happy.
Yeah, that's great. It's top 10 song. Now I really feel why this album was was one of the ones you wanted to choose. I think my only other take from in terms of what singles they release and stuff is we played one more sad song off the top, and it's one of my favorite songs from the album. I feel like that was the best candidate as a second single. Just like, it's only 3 minutes long. The lyrics are also very of the moment and scene. I just look back and it's like a 5 minute follow up to Swing Swing was maybe too long. And then Time Stand Still also didn't chart, but I think was, you know, better well-received than was the last song. Driveway also would have made some sense there. Driveway is probably the most punk song on the album. But really, this was, you know, this was Swing Swing and My Paper Heart. And then, you know, if people dove into the album from there, we're going to talk about how and to what degree people connected with this album after this. All right, so that's their self-titled. Taylor, you mentioned that your first concert was them with The Starting Line. Do you remember when that was? Was it this album or was it Move Along era All-American Rejects?
I think it was Move Along era. I would like to say 2006. I'm not really sure why. Okay. But yeah, it was the All-American Rejects, The Starting Line, The Format, which...
Oh, wow.
If anybody knows... They were, you know, they're now known as Fun, which when I first heard of Fun, I was like, what the fuck is that? And then I was like, oh, The Format. and Gym Class Heroes was also opening the bill.
Oh, wow. My God.
What a lineup.
Yeah, it was at Hammerstein Ballroom in New York City, which is an absolutely gorgeous venue.
Yeah, it's the home of Extreme Championship Wrestling for a long time. A very, very historic wrestling venue also. So
that's a very like quite a 2006 lineup, like just hit after hit.
Yeah. Travie McCoy. Let's go. Let's go. How I've never seen All American Rejects live. How are they?
They were great. I mean, this was a long time ago, but it was definitely, I think, the best first concert I could have gone to. It was a very professional performance, you know, not that they didn't mess around, but it was, you could tell you were watching a professional live band take the stage.
Yeah, that makes sense. You know, I think right from their first album, they were pretty, you know, they have a pretty polished sound. They knew what they were doing. This album, by the way, went platinum in the US and Canada, peaked at number 77 on the US Billboard charts. I received like kind of mixed reviews, but a lot of music at this time did. And it was always, you know, going back and reading some pop punk reviews from this time, it's really hard to tell when the writer is talking about the actual album and when they're just like annoyed of the scene. That was particularly present at Blender. Blender gave it a 1 out of 5, but like none of the criticisms were actually about the All American Rejects. They were just about like pop punk and emo in general. Some places liked it more. All Music gave it a 4 out of 5. Spin gave it an A-. Rolling Stone gave it 3 out of 5. And the general takeaway from the reviews was that there was some real potential here because they were a little polished, because Ritter as a frontman with some crossover vocal appeal and the, you know, the catchiness and the sense of kind of pop sensibility. There was some optimism for them moving forward. They needed more people for touring because obviously two people can't play all those instruments live. They added Chris Gaylor on drums and Mike Kennerty for rhythm guitar. That foursome has been in place since late 2002. And coming off the success of that self-titled, they signed with DreamWorks Records for broader distribution of that album. DreamWorks was a Geffen label as well, and they eventually moved to the Interscope side. So Move Along, the follow-up in 2005, was like triple released through Doghouse, Interscope, and DGC. Move Along in 2005 was a monstrous success. Dirty Little Secret as a single was everywhere. It was on a bunch of soundtracks. Peaked at number 9 and went platinum as a single. And then It Ends Tonight charted as a single, as did the title track, Move Along. Did you stick with All American Rejects like through their history? Like did you were still a fan album by album, or was this more like that was your one album and like how did you engage with them for future albums?
So I definitely liked the self-titled and the follow-up record to that, Move Along. After that, it kind of got a little too indie for me, and I thought the lyrics lost a little bit of heart. So I didn't really pursue them much after that. But like you said, for both of these records and these singles, they went platinum. And yet for some reason, I feel like they tend to be overlooked when it comes to emo and pop punk. I mean, to be fair, I overlook them in my own book.
And I wonder if they were just like in this kind of weird middle ground where like they were almost too successful to have like a cult following like the starting line does, but they didn't sustain that success enough to be like a popular band long term. They're almost in this middle ground where like the exact degree of success that they had meant that they don't have the people caping for them as like, oh, this is a band that should have blown up and didn't. And then they also don't have the people who are like, oh yeah, this band got huge and they're my favorite band. Jake, do you have any thoughts on why maybe they didn't break through? Or sorry, not break through. They broke through. Why they didn't sustain that beyond really... I mean, the follow-up to Move Along did fairly well too, but you know, culturally and the way we remember this band here in 2020, they certainly, you know, fell out of consciousness significantly since Move Along.
I'm kind of stumped by it, to be honest. Like, I think that you're probably right that they almost weirdly had too much success. Like, when I think about, especially lately, like the last three, four years or so, was sort of like the, I don't know what wave you'd call it, but like the emo revival of the last little bit. You've kind of heard almost every band of this era get name checked, but I don't know if I've heard them all that much. And I'm not sure why that is. And I think that it's, I think part of it, I guess, is what you were saying about like the cult-ish following and like the, that they didn't have that. Like so many of these bands from that era, this is probably wrong. And I don't totally mean this exactly as how I'm saying it, but like so many of these bands, I think were kind of liked ironically. And then that became non-ironic by so many people eventually. And I don't know if like this band just had like kind of some really good pop hit singles. And I don't know if they were able to fall into that space.
Yeah, it's a weird thing where they were like, they were exactly as successful as they should have been. Whereas like you can have other bands, like I'll keep using Starting Line as an example because clearly I'm bitter that we didn't get to do that one. But like I will say the Starting Line, based on their music quality and songwriting, like they should have gotten more popular than they did. But there's no one that's going to say that about All American Rejects because they had like immensely popular singles and at least one album that was like huge. So I wonder if that's maybe it. Just to kind of finish up here, off of Move Along, they became this really huge soundtrack band. They were on like Madden soundtracks, MLB, Guitar Hero. They were played on The OC, One Tree Hill, She's the Man, American Wedding. So they got in on the American Pie franchise, which is like the seal of approval for late 90s, early 2000s pop punk. They released When the World Comes Down in 2008 with Gives You Hell as a single, going four times platinum and hitting number four on the charts. I completely forgot that Gives You Hell was a song. I don't know. Like, I think, Taylor, your evaluation is right that, like, it lost a little bit of what made them on the first two albums at this point and Gives You Hell. Like, I don't know. When I went back and listened to it, I was like, this feels to me like a song that got made because we needed another chart single. I don't know. Like, I don't know if that's fair to say for them, but I think it's a good example of your point earlier that, you know, they lost a little bit of the heart and a little bit of what made them. That album didn't reach the peak of Move Along, which again went two times platinum and reached number six on the charts. It also was not loved critically and was pretty much disregarded. And then they released Kids in the Street in 2012, which charted but wasn't really a big commercial or critical success. They have not released an album since 2012. They had planned one in 2013 and they had new songs in 2015, 2016, and 2017. They've also kept touring. They had a good single not that long ago called Sweat. And I guess the reason that an album never came out is they were disillusioned with kind of major label politics at Interscope. They've since been released and in July 2019 signed with Epitaph and released an EP called Send Her to Heaven. They do have a couple EPs since the last album, but nothing substantial. It sure sounds like from them signing with Epitaph and releasing the EP that they were on their way toward new music at some point. Taylor, I guess, with the way the last two albums were and this long a break, would you be excited for new All-American Rejects or just kind of curious and give it a listen to see? Or how would you feel about new Tyson Ritter?
I would be very interested. I would be somewhat skeptical just because aside from the first two records, like I said, they're kind of lacked some sincerity, I think. But I would be really interested to hear any new songs or new record, especially because they signed with Epitaph. Epitaph, I actually interned with them in their press department in my last year of college. So I know the people there and their work ethic is incredible. And they take everything very seriously and they love the music. So if they got on board, I would like to say that it's probably for a good reason, but time will tell.
I hope so. Optimism for 2020 All-American Rejects. Plus, you have all these built-in vehicles to promote the music because Tyson Ritter is an actor now. He's been in Parenthood. He's been in House Bunny as like the lead romantic interest of Anna Faris. And he is also The other show he was in, Jake, have you seen Lodge 49 yet?
No, I hear it's really good, though.
Yeah, I feel like it's a very Jake show, and he plays this super weird character named Avery in it, and he's awesome. He is also barely aged. He still has terrific hair. He still has these amazing cheekbones. Again, I don't want to skew into objectifying poor Tyson Ritter on this podcast, but the guy has looked like a 30-year-old leading man from the time he was 19 till the time he was 40, and I just, like, I know that money helps with some of that, but I would like to know what this guy is doing. Help me out, Tyson.
But I also think that's kind of interesting with this band, too, about how they didn't, like, so much of this scene was, at least back then, was, like, idolizing mostly the front men, sometimes not the front men. And I feel like he never, maybe I'm wrong, and, like, obviously I was not the target demo, but, like, I feel like he never got, like, the Pete Wentz treatment, so to speak.
I was actually just going to jump in with a Pete Wentz. Like, how are you going to have a picture of Pete Wentz in your locker and not Tyson Ritter? Like, what's going on here? Not that, like, there's one standard of attractiveness that applies for everyone. I get that. There are tastes and everyone's good looking in different ways. But yeah, it's a little surprising in retrospect. Guys, at this point in the podcast, this is normally where we pick a couple of our favorite songs from the album, rank them. We structured it around some of the ones that Taylor had suggested. I kind of hinted at my hotter take earlier that I think One More Sad Song is probably my favorite song on this album and should have been a single, and it was a bit of a missed opportunity there. I also really like Time Stand Still and Swing Swing. Jake, when you went back and listened, did anything other than Swing Swing stand out to you as a favorite for you? Because I know, again, you know, Swing Swing was the song you thought of and you hadn't engaged with a lot of the album.
Yeah, I think that Paper Heart I really do like as a song, even though it wouldn't be my pick as an opener. But I do think it's very, I don't know, we've talked this before. I like openers that sort of let you know what you're in for and what's emblematic of the band. I like Don't Leave Me a lot and One More Sad Song as well. But it's hard for me to rank songs this album and not talk about Swing Swing, because, like, I really do think it's, like, a perfect pop song. I've said that before on the show, but a couple songs, but, like, Swing Swing is such a good pop song, and I will not back down from that, despite it being, like, the song. Despite, like, we've talked this as well. Like, there's a tendency of, like, the songs everyone knows to be sort of not the ones people want to talk about, but, like, it's so good. It's such a great pop tune.
It got immensely popular for a reason,
right?
It's a really good song. Jake, I apologize, though. I can't imagine that Swing Swing is going to be the selection. Taylor, what we do at this point in the podcast is we pick a song from the album that we talked about for our Columbia House Party mixtape. It's kind of like a living diary of the show, and one song from each episode goes on. When we have guests on, we generally defer to guests for what they feel, you know, you have the most attachment to, or you feel best represents the episode or your connection to the All-American Rejects. I think you kind of tipped your hand in this regard earlier by calling Time Stand Still one of your top 10 favorite songs ever. But let's hear it. Which song from the All-American Rejects self-titled debut is going on our mixtape?
So there are plenty of obvious choices, but I do agree with you in that I think One More Sad Song is a great single type song, and it's also, again, like the title of My Paper Heart, it's very representative of of the genre that it comes from. So go ahead and throw One More Sad Song on there.
Wow. Ooh. I thought you were going Time Stand Still for sure.
I like it.
Well, Time Stand Still is obviously my favorite, but, you know, I think this one suits the need.
That's great. Taylor, do you have any other thoughts on All American Rejects or on the album before we let you get out of here and let you turn your air conditioner back on?
Yeah, it's like 100 degrees in here. It's fine.
suffering no, to talk just, to us. Oh, God. Yeah,
I'll do anything for the All American Rejects and those perfect cheekbones. But I think the only thing I would have to say is, don't let anyone make you feel guilty about what bands you like and don't like. There was a lot of that going on when I, you know, grew up in this scene, and there still are people who do that. Like, oh, like they're so cheesy, whatever. They're so blatantly emo. Whatever. I love them. I like this kind of music. Just be proud of it and enjoy the fucking songs.
Yeah. I mean, that's the whole point of this podcast, really, is like, you know, no guilty pleasures. And I'm in my 30s and still listening to emo and stuff. I'm probably going to fire up the starting line after this just to, you know, because it came up. And so, yeah, we're with you on that.
And because you're bitter?
Yeah, because we're going to see if you enjoyed coming on, and then we could bring you back for the starting line episode, because I don't know if I trust Jake to help me with the starting line episode all the way. I don't know. sort of throw shots at Jake.
Yeah.
I get it.
Yeah, no, I would definitely be down. I too think that the starting line did not get nearly as big as they should have been. I don't know why they didn't get that big, but they deserve better.
You should do. Please follow Taylor at TK Markarian on Twitter. Keep an eye out for all her freelance work. And check out her book, From the Basement, A History of Emo Music and How It Changed Society. It's awesome. I'm not saying this just because she's on the podcast. I really, really enjoyed it. I read it on a single flight, and I killed it in like one flight. It was such a great nostalgic read, and lined up so well with so much of why I identified with and gravitated toward this kind of music when I was in high school, when I was in my early 20s. So Taylor, thank you for doing the podcast, and thank you for such a great read, From the Basement. Again, it's on Indigo, it's on Barnes & Noble, wherever you get your books. Taylor, thank you so much.
Thank you. It's my pleasure.
Yeah, thank you. This was awesome.